colleagues here today are Faith Jarman, Robert Crouch, Matt Wallach, and Tatiana Fedorenko. Together, we are Geyser Consulting. Monsanto Fund, to matter in the 21st century, must solve problems of global inequality. It is not currently well equipped to do that. The reason for that is because it does not leverage the core competencies of Monsanto. What we find with Walmart is that it leveraged its core competency in supply chain management to drive value for Walmart Foundation. We propose nothing less than that. What is our core competency at Monsanto? It is seeds and data. So we've already decided that we're going to partner with USAID in Ghana. So what are the problems in Ghana today? What are the matters of global import that Monsanto Fund can address to create the future of tomorrow? The critical issues are unsustainable agricultural practices, exacerbated by climate change. Pair that with a population that will double by 2050, and you have a matter of pressing importance, particularly in northern Ghana in its arid population, So we mentioned that we're going to partner with USAID in Ghana. Faith is going to speak more to that.
Thank you, Ayamide. As Ayamide mentioned, we are going to partner with USAID, and this presents us a good opportunity for Monsanto to become a better corporate citizen while advancing social and economic development in Ghana. Our recommendation is to modernize Ghana's agricultural sector by partnering with USAID's Feed the Future initiative in order to find partners to distribute Monsanto seeds and our Climate Corporation mobile technology. We envision starting a partnership by taking some example from Walmart's foundation experience with USAID, including hiring a staff person within Monsanto Fund to liaise with the Monsanto company and USAID's global relationship manager, who will facilitate communication and find local and international partners for us to collaborate with. We'll draft a memorandum of understanding that will outline our strategy and goals in creating a partnership with USAID and implementing partners, and outline criteria to select specific projects. For example, those that have a significant impact on female farmers. We'll specify our cash and in-kind contribution of seeds and access to a free basic mobile technology service. We anticipate that this collaboration with NGOs who have a history of working in Ghana, namely IFDC and ACDI VOCA, as well as Ghanaian organizations and institutions like the Ghana Meteorological Agency and the Ministry of Food and Agriculture. We all have a shared interest in promoting sustainable agriculture. We see the advantages of partnering with USAID as sharing risk among various partners upon our entry into Ghana. USAID has a database of potential partners and existing projects that we can immediately fund to increase scale and scope. With this partnership, we'll have the ability to address social and economic issues dealing with unsustainable agricultural practices and food insecurity affecting a growing Ghanaian population, nearly half of whom are currently living in rural areas. I'll now pass it to Rob, who will discuss the implementation and evaluation of our proposed partnership.
All right, thanks, Faith. So, Monsanto Fund is now partnered with USAID, but how exactly are we going to implement the strategy that we're proposing? Well, we're going to take a two-step approach, and of course that's going to be data services and seeds and training. So with the data services, we will provide the technology that we acquired in our 2014 acquisition of Climate Corporation to collect and track agricultural sector statistics. This will rely on text-based mobile application messaging that we already conduct with over 3 million farmers in India. The next step is going to be seeds and training. We will provide highly customized GMO seeds to subsistence Ghanaian farmers along with advanced farming technique training. Training of how to efficiently farm the land will help reduce food insecurity in northern Ghana. The seeds we provide, free of cost from Monsanto Fund, will be engineered to yield a higher yield per crop, produce more nutritious food for the farmers and for their families. So what kind of timeline are we looking at here? We propose a timeline of 5 years for total implementation hitting certain saturation benchmarks along the way. We want to provide training and seeds for a total of 250,000 farmers, starting with 50,000 in year one. We project, based on the Walmart Foundation's efforts in Rwanda, that we will need to allocate $2.5 million over the 5 years. With our $2.5 million allocation, it will be matched by USAID, bringing our total investment to $5 million. So how will we exactly evaluate how we've done? We will base our success of this project on food insecurity reports from the World Food Program. We strive for a 4% decrease in food insecurity after year two, and for every year in the program afterwards. I will now hand it off to Matt, and he will explain the rationale behind this implementation steps.
Thanks, Rob. So we've been talking about sustainability for Ghana and the company through data and seeds. So why did we choose this plan? As for data, we hope that by training local farmers on our technology, we'll be able to help the local farmers optimize the efficiency of their land, which will ultimately yield, or which will ultimately lead to higher crop yields and ultimately higher revenues. By gaining, and as you can see on this slide here, that Monsanto and through this app can capture billions of observations of data per day. This can lead to georeferencing and yield management zones, which will help us focus our research and development and tailor our seeds to local interests and tastes. As for Monsanto, we can benefit by gaining more data on the global agricultural landscape. There are many possible uses for this data, but one in particular is we can use it to inform our future business development opportunities. Another potential benefit is higher advertising revenue by having more users using our application. And finally, as the Chief Technology Officer has said, Monsanto may be a data company in 5 to 10 years. Having these capabilities in Africa will only serve to strengthen that business line should this become the strategic vision going forward. Tanya will now discuss how seeds will help with sustainability.
Yeah, thank you. So by providing seeds and training the farmers how to use them seeds, it's not gonna fulfill only our mission, it's gonna benefit Ghana and ultimately Monsanto itself. As we already mentioned, Ghana is facing some challenges such as climate change and significant population growth. So by 2050, we're gonna need to double the amount of food we're producing now. As you can see on the table, the GM seeds yield more kilogram per acre than as a normal seed. So with our resources, with our knowledge and our technology, we will be able to develop a seed that will be a resistant and engineered to endure the climate in Ghana. Our seeds will bring Ghana more food, more jobs, and more income. So what's gonna be beneficial for us? So first of all, by partnershiping with, partnershiping with USAID, we're gonna be able to develop a significant footprint and for our future business development in Ghana and Africa itself. Also, we are expecting or we're hoping we may have potential buyers there. When farmers realize how beneficial the seeds are for them, we're expecting them to be our customers. Also, we may use the example of Walmart, and these farmers can become our potential supplier who will contribute to our sustainable supply chain in the future.
So we've discussed here today two problems and two solutions. There's a problem for Monsanto Farm. It doesn't currently leverage the core competencies of Monsanto, which are seeds and data. The solution is to leverage those core competencies and then to allow for training of Ghanaian farmers that will lead to agricultural sustainability. The problem for Ghana is that agricultural lack thereof of safe sustainability. And our solution then is training, seeds, and data. In doing so, we've arrived at the conclusion: seeds plus data equals sustainability. Thank you.
Start with the questions and answers. how you plan to overcome their natural resistance to genetically modified seeds. And I suspect, from what I understand, there's resistance right up through the bureaucracy of the country to that,
sure.
Not just the farmers. How do you plan to deal with that?
Yeah, so I think that the science is on our side. You know, genetically modified crops have never been shown to be have negative health effects. However, we do have a backup plan. So should we be met with resistance, we have another product called BioAg, which essentially strengthens the soil instead of the crop, instead of the seeds. And so if, like I said, if we are met with resistance for GMO seeds, then we can introduce, and this is a natural product, that will, again, help with the strengthening of the crops and hopefully lead to higher yields and higher revenue.
I think we can also say that our product will prove itself. It's not going to be 100% backlash or protest. So where we do give our seeds, where they see the yield, where they see how much crops we're providing or growing, how much food it's yielding, then that will in itself prove that this is not the worst thing, that the backlash against who we are and what we do is unwarranted.
We believe Africa is just facing such a huge challenge, so their problem is not going to be the first time the GM seeds is going to be how we can actually feed our country.
So I know you said you're going to make a $5 million commitment. Do you have a slide that shows the financials of how that's going to be allocated? Or?
Okay, well, we based our $2.5 million because we're getting the matching from USAID.
Well, that's total $5
million. Yeah. We based our $2.5 million based on the Walmart in Rwanda. Their example, they allocated $400,000 per year, or $400,000 total, and they were only able to train 37,000 farmers. So we think that this is a proper financial goal for us, or financial allocation for us.
And if I might add, the specifics will really depend on the particular projects that we fund. They might have, they will definitely have different line items that we don't have projections for at the moment.
I've got a question. You mentioned using the technology and text messages, and it was unclear exactly who would be using the technology and how can you be sure that they have what they need in order to use it?
Sure. So we currently, through Climate Corp, the company that we acquired in 2014, serve over 3 million Indian farmers. Many of these farmers are illiterate, poor, destitute, all the things that you can imagine. These farmers use our Climate Corp app, a basic version of it, and with that they can see what the weather conditions may be in the upcoming season, and they can evaluate all the things that they need. Now, we hope to apply that to rural northern Ghana. If we can do it with 3 million Indian farmers, we fully believe that we can also achieve that with the rural farmers in northern Ghana.
I think it may be surprising, too, that through our research, we found that 60% of rural the rural population in northern Ghana, 60% actually have cell phones. So our app is going to be SMS-based, so it's not a smartphone, it's just basic text message capabilities. So we have already a 60% population with cell phones that'll lend itself easier to initiate this program.
And maybe you could just help me on this. There was something about advertising revenue growth. How does that fit into the overall?
I think that's just a kind of an aside. It's not something that is a big revenue stream for us, but it's just something that can be a benefit to the company. So as we train the local population on our ad, obviously we will have more users of the application, and then that can lead to more higher advertising revenues from companies that want to advertise on the app, through the app.
As the agricultural sector in Ghana modernizes, so as the farmers become more prosperous, we believe that companies will want to target them more. And as Rob mentioned, 60% of them already have mobile phones. So we see that as something that is
also discussed donating that revenue, at least for the first 5 years, to avoid any self-dealing issues, because that, to us, seemed to be the only potential benefit for the company that could be seen as self-dealing.
And I'm just curious, you've mentioned as an alternative the enhancement of soil. Why is that the alternative as opposed to the primary recommendation, given the resistance?
Because right now our seeds are our main source of our main business. It's what we have done for years, and it's what has a proven track record. I think that the soil is a product that is up and coming, and you know, we have this huge looming issue of not only climate change but also population change, and so because our seeds have a proven track record, that's why we chose the seeds.
If we can get a higher yield from our GMO seeds, we're going to go with those first. If the backlash is too intense or what have you, then we can bring in our traditional seeds, which we do provide as a company, and our soil enhancer, which will still grow crops and provide, you know, food, but it won't be on the scale as with the GMO seeds.
And so what about in terms of the partnerships that you've mentioned, they're going to be buying into this whole concept? What's been their perspective on the approach that you're taking as opposed to going towards soil enrichment as the primary driver?
So in Ghana with USAID, we're at the preliminary stages of this development. What we're currently looking at is looking what is our core competency and looking how we can leverage that with what USAID provides. Now, we're ready to listen. And if it is the case that USAID and the situation there in Ghana would more clearly benefit from something like Fertilizer BioLab, then we also have that available. But we're coming to the table with USAID and Ghana ready to provide seeds and funds.
You mentioned the Walmart program that you study. What would you do differently from the funding they do elsewhere?
So I think Walmart, they worked with rural farmers in Rwanda and Bangladesh. I think that they, although their core competency is supply chain management, and they're able to envelop these farmers into their supply chain down the line, I don't think that that is as good of a resource that they could have used. So their core competency is not investing in rural farmers. So there are probably further areas where they could look to leverage their supply chain management skills. China, for instance, is a huge source of labor for Walmart products. So there are other areas of the world, and it's a geographic thing rather than an implementation thing. So.
Any questions?
I think also, just quickly if I may, I think also part of this is how strategic this opportunity could be for us. You know, Africa, as we had mentioned, the population is going to double by 2050, and this is a huge potential opportunity for us down the road. Whereas, you know, Bangladesh and Rwanda were smaller, kind of niche markets, so to speak. Whereas this, we look at as kind of the long term picture, the long term play that we can hope to hopefully leverage these our core competencies with seeds and data to, you know, gain more market share down the road.
There are some agriculture paths specialized, you know, in African countries. Did you look at those and did you try to compare the USAID Monsanto partnership you are proposing to the other ones? If they would be better or not? Did you consider this idea?
We did. I think it was, you know, the prompt had told us to partner with USAID.
Okay.
So that was really, I think, the main driver, one of the main drivers for sticking with USAID. But we definitely looked into other options.
I was just thinking in terms of benchmarking.
Yeah.
I understand, of course, you have to stay with USAID.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.